the designing issue of PCB. In selecting a pump, two most critical requirements are: the pump should have sufficient displacement capacity and the pump should have sufficient pressure capacity to overcome the net lift required for the application. So the first one is comes under volume design, and second one comes under the pressure design. So from the reservoir deliverability studies, we will come to know about what should be the desired rate of our well production. And so based on that, we need to select the model of our pump which has enough eccentricity, minor dia and the pitch length of our pump, so to have the desired flow rate what we are designing for. And so here is the methodology of deriving the relationship between this pump parameters and displacement volume. So let us take this as an stator and this red one is rotor. If you can see here, the area covered by our stator elastomer cavity will be equal to 4 times into eccentricity, as we know that this half diameter is equal to 2e, and so this full square will be of 4e, right? So this length is our 4e, and the diameter of rotor, the minor diameter of rotor is small d, so the square will be equal to 4e into d, right? And then these two semicircles in our stator will be equal to, combining both of them will be equal to the area of this rotor. So if we subtract the area of rotor from our stator, then we will get the cavity area of d into 4e. And if we multiply that cavity area with our pitch length, then we will get what will be the volume displacement of our this PCP configuration in given rotation. So assuming that there is one rotation per minute and for whole day that pump is working, then we will get this formula that volume pump displacement will be equal to this constant C into eccentricity into diameter, minor diameter of rotor, and into the pitch length. So you can simply convert this formula by putting conversion constant here, and you will get this constant C. Now this is for SI unit. If you want the flow rate in barrels per day per RPM, then you can convert simply from meter cube per day to barrels per day. Then so this is the nomenclature. Now this pump displacement we get is for 1 RPM in means 1 rotation per minute, but if our pump will have more RPMs, then we will just multiply that RPM with our volume displacement. Means that there will be, for example, n rotations and n is equal to 275 RPM. Then if we multiply that 275 with our pump displacement, then we will get total displacement in that much of RPM. So the actual, if we want actual flow rate, then we multiply this pump displacement with rotational speed. To understand it better, let us see this sum. To calculate the pump displacement and theoretical rate for a pump with eccentricity is given, minor rotor dia is given, pitch length is given, and pitch length is nothing but cavity length as we saw in previous slides, and the operational speed is given. So by this pump displacement formula, we can simply write that V will be equal to CE D and into P. So this will give us flow rate in SI units, which will be equal to this. And if we multiply rotational speed with this pump displacement, then we will get the actual theoretical flow rate, which is equal to this. So this value will be equal to theoretical flow rate, but we know that there's a term called slippage. So if we want to get this much amount of flow rate of 70 meter cube per day, then we will have to design our pump to have a flow rate of nearly 85 or 90% 90 meter cube per day of flow, because there's a term called slippage which will result into the volumetric efficiency. So we know that volumetric efficiency is equal to actual flow rate divided by the design flow rate. So we will see it in the next slide. So here it is. The design flow rate of our pump should be equal to actual flow rate divided by volumetric efficiency. And if we divide that design flow by pump rotation speed, then we will get the minimum required pump displacement. So this minimum required pump displacement can be calculated by the formula we saw in previous slide, which is equal to C into E D and into P. So we need to take care that we are not supposed to design our pump based on actual flow rate, but we need to design it on the basis of Q design by considering the volumetric efficiency of pump. So this was about the volume design. So now let us understand the pressure design. As we all know that P lift of any pump will be equal to P discharge minus the P intake pressure. P lift is the net amount of lift created by that particular pump. So then how we calculate P discharge and P intake to know what will be our P lift amount? So let first of all see that what is P intake. So P intake is equal to P casing head pressure plus the P pressure which is exerted by a gas column, and P plus P liquid, the pressure which is exerted by a liquid column. So to know this, how this come, we need to see the configuration of PCP valves. So this is the typical configuration of our PCP valve. There will be certain rise in the level of fluid in the annulus section, then there will be gas column, the gas which is liberated from reservoir fluid, and there will be certain back pressure exerted by casing head. So the pump intake pressure will be equal to casing head back pressure plus the pressure exerted by gas column and plus the pressure exerted by our liquid column. So that is the value of intake pressure. We can select what amount of back pressure we want to give by casing head pressure. So this value we know, P gas and P liquid can be calculated by this formula, H into P into C, which is basically rho g H. And this value P discharge will be equal to back pressure exerted by our tubing plus the P liquid column plus the pressure losses. Here we need to understand that P liquid will be equal to this much of height, means the height which is equal to pump setting depth minus the height of the rise of the fluid in our annulus. So P liquid will be that value, and P losses will depend upon the viscosity of fluid. More viscous the fluid, more will be the losses. Fluid flow along the tubing, what kind of flow it is, how it is affecting our back pressure and friction formulas. Then depending upon this, coupling guide and centralizers used in that rod and elevated flow rate. So this flow losses can be obtained by certain correlations with this four values. And P liquid is obtained by HP into C again. And we can set back pressure by tubing depending on what amount of and to what distance we want to cover our fluid after it reaches to the wellhead. So we get P discharge and P intake. If we subtract P intake from P discharge, then we will get the net amount of lift we want from our pump. So now we can calculate the volume configuration of our PCP, and we also know that what should be the P lift amount. Now we will calculate the power rating requirements by our PCP pump. As we know, power is equal to flow rate generated into delta P. So we will use that formula and see that how much power will be required by our PC pump to generate the design flow rate and the P lift required. So now, with the help of P lift and pump displacement, let us calculate what will be the torque and power requirements of our PC pump. First, torque requirements. Now we know the definition of torque, that torque can be defined as energy required to turn the rotor and move the fluid against the pressure. This torque can be of two types, hydraulic and friction. So the friction torque is the energy required to overcome the interference bit between the rotor and stator. And friction torque is dependent on interference bit, type of rotor coating, stator elastomer, lubricating properties of fluid, and pump length. So this many parameters goes into the friction torque, so it can be calculated by correlations, or we can get its value by test bench calculation. In test bench, we calculate the total torque, and from that we subtract the hydraulic torque to get the friction torque of our pump. And we can calculate hydraulic torque with this formula of pump displacement into P lift, and there's a C constant. So the hydraulic torque formula will be equal to C into V into P lift. So if we know friction torque and we know hydraulic torque, then we can calculate the total amount of torque. And if we multiply that total torque with the pump rotation speed, and there will be a constant C multiplied with them to make it in a favorable units, we will get the power requirements of pump. So you saw that with just help of P lift and our pump displacement, we can calculate the torque, and we can also calculate the power requirements of our PC pump. So by using all these four parameters, we can generate a characteristic curve of our PCP model, and that is called the PCP performance chart, which we will learn in next slide. But the designing of the PCP includes this much parameters only. There is also some parameters like designing of sucker rod, but that is on too much mechanical side, so we will not see it. We will just see that how to design our volume, how to design pressure, how to get torque requirement and power requirement. So this is how our performance chart look like. It has three axes in it. First one is X, which is pump rotation speed axis. Second one is Y axis, which is flow rate axis, and third one is power at shaft axis. It means that how much power our shaft will require for given amount of head and to generate a given amount of flow rate. So this chart has two sets of straight lines. First one is the parallel lines, which indicates the relationship between flow rate and our RPM. Here you can see this parallel lines. They are governed by Y is equal to MX plus C. But in case of our zero head line, the equation of line will be Y is equal to MX. And because for zero flow rate, it will pass through zero RPM speed. Because there is no amount of slip, basically that in Y is equal to MX plus C, that C stands for our amount of slippage. So if we increase the requirement of our head, as we saw in previous slide, if delta P increases, there will be increase in amount of slippage, So as the requirement of our head increases, there will be increased amount of C, which is basically the slippage of our pump. The second lines are dash lines, which are used to estimate the power required at the given shaft. Means if we know our flow rate amount, if we know how much head we want to generate, then we will be able to know that what RPM our pump should operate. And if we know these three parameters, then we will be able to easily calculate the power requirement at the shaft with the help of the formula which we saw in previous slide. So for example, we want 200 meter cube of flow rate and want to generate 1500 meter of head, then we will require to run our pump at 365 RPMs, and it will require 75 HP of power at our shaft. So this is how we can read our performance chart. There are two values given here. One is in meter and other one is in feet. So you may understand it. Rest is theory. This part is theory, which we already covered. So now we will see defects in pump. So defects in PCP can occur at two sites, rotor and stator, because they are the most operational part of PC pump. So let's first of all see rotor failure modes. First one is abrasive wear. It is wearing of chrome plating and base metal. It may permanently damage the elastomer of stator. Crash part of rotor is most vulnerable to it. It happens due to abrasive and solid productions, means abrasive solid productions. So what happens is the solids get tends to accommodate in the crease part of our rotor, and at that part the friction between that solids and our chrome plating increases, and there would be wearing of this chrome plate. And once the chrome plate gets wear, the metal surface will get into contact with elastomer, and the coefficient of friction increases there. So there will be chance of permanent damage of elastomers too. So how could we protect this kind of wear? So by using sunscreen, we can protect this kind of wear. If we won't allow producing stream to have solids in it, then this wear won't occur. Second is acid attack. The acid of pH below 6 strips off the hard chrome plate of rotor. So if we do acidization, keeping the pump in wellbore, then our acid will strips off this chrome plating, and in this case also metal will get in contact with elastomer, and there could be damage to elastomer. Third kind of failure is torsional failure. It occurs if the pump locks up for any reason. Under this situation, a portion of rotor locks up while the remaining portion of rotor wants to keep rotating. So in case of more solid production or elastomer failure, or if the elastomer is oversized, means it has expanded oversized, then that oversized portion will try to hold rotor and it won't allow it to rotate. So at that point there could be a twist of our this rotor. So twist off will look like this when it occur. The fourth kind of rotor failure mode is pitting corrosion. Despite the hard surface and relatively low coefficient of friction, hard chrome plating is porous, and under the right condition, component of the producing fluids enter these pores and begin to corrode the base metal under the chrome. And once the base metal has been eroded away under the chrome, the chrome in that area will pop off, leaving a pit in it. So in the stream of producing fluid, there will be certain components which will be passing the hard chrome plating and will enter into base metal. They will start to erode, our base metal, and once certain amount is eroded, there will be popping of our this chrome plate. So there will be pits in the base metal then. So that is called pitting corrosion. And the fifth kind of failure is improper rotor spacing. Basically, it's not a material failure, but a failure due to improper installation procedure. If the proper amount of stretch is not accounted for, the rotor placement within the stator could either be too high or too low. And in either cases, excess stress are placed on rotor and sucker rods and may result in torsional failure of either the rotor or sucker rods. So in case of not enough space out, there will be a contact of horizontal rod which is situated in our tack bar and the rotor, because in case of not enough space out, there will be less distance available between that horizontal rod and our rotor rod, because distance is actually of 30 centimeters only. So in that case, there will be compression on that rotor string, and potentially it can cause a premature failure of rotor as well as that of tack bar. And in case of too much space out, there will be reduced contact with the pump stages, and thus there will be overpressurizing of the pump, because effectively there will be less cavities which are lifting the same amount of fluid to same lift. And there could also be excessive unidirectional bending of the rotor, which can cause it to break. So this were the rotor failure modes. Now we will see stator failure modes. So the most common type of stator failure mode is dry run. A pump that has run dry has its elastomer hard, brittle and extensively cracked. So in dry run, if our producing fluid has gas more than 30%, means there is 30% gas void ratio, then there will not be sufficient heat dissipation by our producing fluid, and that heat will concentrate on our elastomer, and elastomer will swell, or it will become hard, it will become brittle, or it will get extensively cracked. And if in the extreme conditions, this elastomer will blister, like we can see here, or it can burn. So we will lose our stator contour. So the slippage effect will increase and our pump life expectancy will decrease. Similarly, in case of abrasion, if there are solids being produced with producing fluid, then they will wear our ID of our stator, and thus it will reduce our ID of stator, and it will also result in more amount of sleep and eventually decrease in our pump life expectancy. Excessive elastomer swell is also a stator failure mode problem. It occurs if elastomer is incompatible to reservoir fluids, treatment chemical, or in presence of excessive temperature. This swell also results in increase in the interference fit between the rotor and stator, and thereby in an increase in operating torque. So in case of excessive swelling, it won't allow our rotor to rotate, and thus it will increase our torque rating, and elastomer may bulge out of the stator cylinder, like we can say in this picture. So in this case also, the fit between rotor and elastomer will get disturbed, so there will be inefficiency in flowing our fluid. So fourth problem is gas permeation and explosive decompression due to it. Gas permeation occurs when the gas under pressure enters the elastomer matrix and expands due to pressure drop. It causes blistering if the pressure is less while our gas is expanding again at the time of pressure drop, then blistering will occur. And if the pressure is high, then explosive decompression will occur. Means this pressure drop may occur when we are pulling out our pump or when our pump is shut down. So at that time, the gas which has permeated in the elastomer will try to expand, and in that expansion it may cause blistering to our pump. And if more amount of gas has entered in to the elastomer, then it will create high pressure and thus explosive decompression also occur. So a part of elastomer will just teared out of this stator assembly. So first problem, bond failure. A bond failure occurs when the bonding agent that keeps the elastomer in stator tube fails. Means if our bonding glue will not hold our elastomer with our stator tube, then that is called bonding failure. Basically in this, elastomer will get rupture from certain positions where our glue is failing. Sixth problem is delamination. In process of preparing our elastomer contour, laminated layers are often formed in elastomer as the result of temperature fluctuations during the injection process. So when we are injecting our this elastomer, then our die, then there will be laminated layers formed due to this temperature fluctuations, and in operating conditions due to high pressure of gas, it will permeate in this laminated layers. And when a pressure drop will occur, the gas that has entered this laminated areas will expand, and thereby it will tear the weak areas of our elastomer, and thus it will affect our performance. Seventh is hysteresis. Hysteresis is the result of over pressuring the elastomer. In this situation, the elastomer is working harder than it is designed for, and therefore fails prematurely. Fails prematurely means elastomer loses its elastic property. That is what we call hysteresis. So hysteresis occurs in minor diameter of the stator. Minor diameter is the thicker section of the rubber. Means here there is thicker section of the rubber, so the distance between them is called minor diameter, and hysteresis will primarily occur in these areas because there is more elastomer available. So after learning various aspects of PCP, let us see some of its advantages. It is low capital cost system. Initial installation doesn't cost much, and even it is low maintenance cost system, so maintenance will also be less, so we will have to spend very less from upfront. And it is also highly efficient system, so its efficiency lies between 40 to 60%. And it is low power consumption system, so it consumes less power. So this four parameters says us that it is very cost effective solution to artificial lift the fluid. It is simple to install and has quiet operations, and has low surface profile for visual and height sensitive areas. So this 2 point says that it can also be used in urban areas. And it has low surface profile because it will just have well head drive at surface, and there will be VFD at the well site. Then it pumps oil and water with solids. So out of other artificial lift system, it has a very good tendency to tolerate the solids, but of course there should be some limit to it. And last is portable surface equipment. So this equipments are portable, unlike SRP. So replacement and maintenance will be faster, so operations will keep on continuing to occur. Every good thing comes with its own limitation. So does the PCP also have its own limitation? It has limited depth capability, means that if we will increase depth, there will be increase in amount of slippage. So we will get less flow rate as we increase depth, so depth is limitation. Second one is temperature. If there is more amount of temperature, then elastomer swell will occur, and elastomer swell will hold our rotor. There will be increase in torque. Third thing is sensitivity to producing fluid. This producing fluid may enter into our base metal, and then pitting corrosion may occur, or it may have adverse effect to our elastomer also, as we saw. Low volumetric efficiencies in high environment, high gas environments, means if there will be increase in gas void percentage, then there will be dry run and the volumetric efficiency will decrease. Potential for tubing and rod failure. Whole system is in rotation from top till the bottom, so there is very high chance of tubing and rod failure, and also coupling wear. So after seeing the advantages and limitations of PCP, let us see application considerations of it. So gas handling capacity of PCP is good. It can tolerate up to 30% gas void fraction, so it is very good. Solid handling capacity is excellent. Fluid gravity means it can lift the API fluid gravity of up to 35 degree. Beyond this, there will be very less viscosity, so the slippage will increase. Servicing can easily be done with workover or even with pulling rig, so that cost can be saved. Then gas or electric type prime mover can be used for it power purpose. Then it is also good for offshore applications because it has very low footprint, but we need to understand that there is operation depth limitation also for that. So if the in offshore there is depth of only 2000 to 4500 feet of TVD, then we may use this kind of system. Then system efficiency is 40 to 70%, which is highest in all the lift kinds. Then corrosion handling capability is also fair for it. Then it has very good range of flow rate deliverability, so it can deliver a flow of as small as 5 BPD, means barrel per day, to 2200 BPD. Then operating temperature range is 75 to 150 degree Fahrenheit. This is the maximum range up to what it can tolerate, and this is the optimum range. We should try to operate in this, and up to this it is the maximum range. Now wellbore deviation, it can work in 0 to 90 degree of the well, means completely vertical to horizontal wells, but provided that there should be a build up angle of less than 15 degree per 100 feet. So according to all this criteria, this PCP application is suited for following four domains, means it is ideal lift for this four domains. First is sand laden, heavy crude oil and bitumen. Second is coal bed methane. Third is high water cuts well, and fourth is all type of well, including vertical, horizontal and deviated. All type means the profile of wells. So that's all about PCP. Thank you.